Good evening. I'm Brian Taylor. Many of you know me, a few may not. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Urban Planning, and I direct the Institute of Transportation Studies here in the Luskin School. It's my honor to welcome you to the 8th Annual Martin Wax Distinguished Lecture in Transportation, to be delivered this evening by Patricia Mokhtarian of Georgia Tech. This has been a very busy and high-profile start to the academic year in Transportation Studies here at UCLA. Last week during orientation, the Fall UCLA Regents Lecture was delivered by Jeanette Sadakan, the dynamic former Transportation Commissioner for the City of New York. And this afternoon, during the first week of classes, we heard from Andre Boutros, who's the Executive Director of the California Transportation Commission. In the coming weeks, UCLA students and faculty are going to hear from Hassan Akrata, the Executive Director of the Southern California Association of Governments, who's going to be speaking on goods movement planning, Michelle Boehm, who is the Southern California Director of the California High-Speed Rail Authority, Marlon Bornett, from that university that shall not be named, on bus and rail integration in Los Angeles, Emily Castor from Lyft, one of the new transportation network companies, and finally, UCLA alum Karen Trappenberg Frick from UC Berkeley, who will speak on the Tea Party and transportation planning. But this evening is perhaps our most special one, and a particular highlight of the fall. The lecture is named in honor of UCLA and UC Berkeley Professor Emeritus Martin Wax, who, along with his lovely wife Helen and his daughter-in-law, is here this evening. We have been blessed these past 6 years to have Professor Emeritus Wax back at UCLA, working with students on classes and research projects. Now, Professor Wax, for those who may not know him, spent 25 years on the UCLA Urban Planning faculty between 1971 and 1996, serving 3 terms as head of the Urban Planning Program. In addition to his prominent and productive work as a scholar of transportation policy and planning, Professor Wax also won numerous teaching awards and built a loyal and grateful coterie of former students, the ranks of which continue to swell to the present day as he's been teaching in our program. He then moved north to UC Berkeley for a decade to head the University of California Transportation Center and the Institute of Transportation Studies there. That was an era that we here at UCLA like to refer to as the lost years. Upon his retirement from Berkeley, his former students, and of which I am proudly one, established this lecture series here in his honor. And here at UCLA, we also established an endowed scholarship in his honor. And in fact, we have materials, should you be interested in contributing to the Wax Scholarship, and we have used it to recruit some of the best and brightest students to UCLA for transportation studies, and it was recently endowed. Now, since 2006, the lecture has alternated between UC Berkeley and UCLA. The previous Wax lecturers have been Bent Flueberg of Aalborg University in Denmark, Tony May of Leeds University in England, Susan Hansen from Clark University, Alan Altshuler from Harvard University, Genevieve Giuliano, who's here today, from that other university. Maypo Kwan from The Ohio State University. Edward Glazer from Harvard University. And this evening, Patricia Mokhtarian from Georgia Tech. Now, Professor Mokhtarian is quite simply the most widely acknowledged and accepted expert, one of the most widely acknowledged and accepted experts on travel behavior. Much of her early work examine the influence of information and communication technologies on work and travel. And no one, to my knowledge, has written more extensively or with more authority on telecommuting, e-shopping, and the like. She also began making quite a splash about a decade ago with her work turned to the positive utility of travel, that is, travel for travel's sake, and the role that lifestyles and preferences and other activities during travel can make in our travel choices. And we will hear more about her thinking and evolution of work on this evening. Even more recently, she and her colleagues have tackled the thorny question of self-selection in understanding the links between land use and travel. That is, do people in some neighborhoods travel by foot, bike, and public transit more and drive less in those neighborhoods because of the physical characteristics of that neighborhood that they live in? Or because people with those predilections are likely to locate in those neighborhoods that enable them to operationalize those choices? And her work has been some of the best at trying to untangle that thorny question. Now, collectively, Professor Mokhtarian's research on these and related topics has been cited over 11,000 times, due both to its policy relevance and to the fact that all of her research is distinguished by meticulous attention to research design. Given the uniform rigor of her work and her willingness to let the chips fall where they may with respect to her findings, I cannot think of another transportation scholar who can more quickly change my thinking on a particular topic than Professor Mokhtarian. In other words, if Professor Mokhtarian's research produces findings that run counter to my assumptions, I am more likely to question my assumptions than I am the validity of her findings. And it's normally the other way around. Now, Professor Mokhtarian holds a BA in mathematics from Florida State University, an MS and PhD degrees in industrial engineering and management sciences from Northwestern University. She has ties here to Southern California, having spent a decade here, first as a postdoctoral scholar at UC Irvine, then on the staff of the Southern California Association of Governments, affectionately known as SCAG here, and then as a private consultant before joining the faculty at UC Davis, where she spent 23 years as a valued colleague to the North, before joining the faculty in civil and environmental engineering at Georgia Tech last year. We're delighted to have Professor Mokhtarian back in Southern California this evening, where she will deliver a lecture entitled, What Good Is It? Reflections on the Utility of Travel in a Resource-Constrained Era. Please join me in welcoming the 2014 Martin Wax Distinguished Lecturer, Patricia Mokhtarian.
Thank you, Brian. Those are words that I aspire to live by. I hope I generally do, but very difficult to live up to it all the time. Thanks to all of you for coming, especially those of you who might have braved any Obama traffic. I really appreciate your dedication to coming out on a night like this. And it's such a joy and a privilege to have the opportunity to honor Marty in this way. I've been a longtime member of the Marty Wax fan club. I know its numbers are legion. And we all can say many wonderful things about Marty and his towering intellect and his widespread knowledge of everything, his impeccable scholarship, his ironclad commitment to ethics, no matter what. So it's no surprise that his fans are many, but when I tell people who haven't had the fortune of knowing Marty about him, here's what I tell them. I say, you know, I get dozens, scores of emails every day, and many of them are actually from people I want to communicate with. Notice not all, but I have emails from former students, from longtime friends, and I really want to keep in touch with these people, and yet I just get more emails in the course of a day than I can possibly keep up with. And so in my very own inbox are messages months old, maybe longer, from... Better? Should I hold it or just...
No, just that.
Yeah. Okay. Ah, I see. So, you know, friends that I would like to keep in touch with, and yet, you know, again, each day I have more email than I can answer in that day, and so they just get farther and farther back in the queue, and I never get around to them. But Marty, I mean, I've never failed to write him, but what I hear back from him, usually within hours, often within minutes, you know, never more than a day. And I just don't know how he does it. I know he's got way more students than I do former students who are, you know, clamoring for his attention, and way more contacts in the universe than I do, and over the transom messages that just come in asking for his time. So I actually learned a little bit more this afternoon about how he does it, which is, you know, some long hours late at night that he would prefer to be doing more productive things sometimes. But, you know, his priority to responding to messages and to his former students, communications, and so forth, just tell me that he has a heart for people, and that's really why I think the fan club is so large and why it's such an honor to be a part of this special event. So when Brian first contacted me about this talk, my first reaction was, of course, wow, I did not expect that, didn't see it coming, and what an honor and a privilege it would be, so of course I'm going to do it. My second reaction, very close on the heels, was, oh my goodness, what am I going to talk about, right? And so, you know, what to do? Something new, you know, you want to be fresh and innovative, but I'd better stick pretty close to what I know, or I could end up looking pretty silly. But if I stick real close to what I know, then I'm just rehashing old stuff, and people say, yeah, she was saying that a decade ago, what has she done lately? So obviously the golden mean is to try to take a topic that you know something about and maybe talk about its history and its current development, but also look forward to the future and think about some research directions that might be in order. So that's what I'm trying to do tonight. And after some contemplation, I chose the topic of how ordinary people feel about travel. It seems like a very humble subject in some ways, and yet I think it has rather far-reaching repercussions in policy and planning and so forth. It has the added benefit of involving my friend and colleague Elon Solomon, who is also a longtime friend of Marty's. And so Elon started me down this road, as you can see, more than 20 years ago, or almost 20 years ago, and it's been a very interesting journey in many ways. So when I was thinking about this subject over the years, and especially more recently, I would say, I've been struck by what seems to me almost a schizophrenia about how we talk about travel, especially in scholarly writings, perhaps. I mean, on the one hand, we do, at the aggregate level, talk about transportation playing a role in economic development and prosperity and industrial productivity. But on the other hand, we worry about its contribution to congestion and energy consumption and emissions and greenhouse gases and now obesity. At the disaggregate level, we grant that transportation can add to our subjective well-being and our quality of life, but it's also a source of stress and clearly a disutility that we try to minimize. And so, you know, we have this mixed emotions, if you will, about transportation. And it seems to me nowadays that the discussion is more one-sided than that, and that is that we're often focusing on the negative aspects of transportation, that it's evil, and therefore that we need to reduce it. Certainly vehicular travel we need to reduce. I've read many papers in which the introduction is all about, you know, how terrible congestion is and air quality and this and that. And I'm like, but wait a minute, there's a good side too. And so one of the purposes of my talk here is to try to restore a little bit of that balance, and I will draw on a number of disciplinary sources to do that, again, running the risk of dipping into subjects about which I know little, but at least I will hopefully provide some food for thought. So just by way of a brief overview of what we'll do, I want to spend some time establishing that this idea of a dual nature of both goods and behaviors is very well entrenched in psychology, marketing research, and others. So we're going to talk about the utilitarian nature of goods, activities, and in general, and travel in particular, but also the autotelic or hedonic nature of those types of things. I will obviously then apply it to travel, and provide some empirical evidence, I hope convincing, for this autotelic or hedonic aspect of travel. We'll talk about implications for understanding travel behavior before having a long series of questions that this may raise. So I'll be concluding with more questions than answers, but that's really why we're in a university, isn't it? To establish some directions for future research. So I want to start off by pepping things up, giving you a bold new insight that you may not have heard anywhere else before. You've heard it here first. Now, drum roll, eating is a derived demand. Obviously, right? It's a disutility. It consumes time and monetary resources that you cannot then use on other goods. We obviously only eat in order to stay alive. We don't eat for its own sake. And therefore, clearly, we're going to try to minimize the time and cost that we spend on eating. Well, we're giggling because, actually, that's not really true, is it? At least for most of us, much of the time. In fact, most of us often eat more food than the minimum required to live, and we often spend way more money than the minimum required to eat. And under many circumstances, we enjoy eating for its own sake, not just for its utilitarian purpose of keeping us alive. And it's clear that eating is endowed with many functions, both symbolic and hedonic, as well as the functional one. So that got me to thinking, all right, it's true of a very common activity like eating. And the more I start started paying attention, the more I saw this duality, if you will, in a number of places and a number of disciplines. It seems that both activities, behaviors, and goods or products often have this dual nature. So I want to expand on those ideas, first talking about goods. In the marketing research literature, they are very commonly referring to consumer products as having both functional and hedonic benefits. I started to go crazy with, you know, Google Images, finding, you know, this idea of the fact that we can take something very functional like a shoe and endow it with all of these decorative qualities. And I wanted to talk about, you know, household utensils like knives and hammers and forks, and also consumer electronics like iPods and phones and so forth. But I decided to restrict my images to transportation-related ones. But here on the next few slides, we'll see examples in which we just have the urge, it seems, to decorate or to endow with beauty or to provide some kind of aesthetic aspect to things that also have a very utilitarian function. Whether it's small items like shoes, medium items like bicycles and even wheelchairs, large items like buildings, bridges. Beautiful, aren't they? I mean, these are more than just functional. Streets, roads, we beautify them. We, you know, take great care in making them lovely as well as functional. Vehicles, spend a lot of time decorating vehicles. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder in some cases, but let's face it, a lot of time went into those vehicles. And even bus stops and subway cars, we're constantly decorating and adding frills, if you will, to the objects that we also use in a very functional way in everyday life. So as Brian indicated in the introduction, you didn't hear anything about art history in that introduction, so I'm no art historian, but I did stumble across the philosophy of Art Nouveau, and it struck me as representing exactly the kind of thing I'm talking about. It's a total art style, embracing all these different things, and it should be a way of life in which we combine the fine arts and applied arts, even for utilitarian objects. So that philosophy seems to me to encapsulate very clearly this idea that objects can have both a hedonic as well as a utilitarian component. And similarly, the whole branch of industrial design is all about, you know, the design, ergonomics, aesthetics, etc., and, you know, the contrast between engineering focusing principally on functionality or utility, whereas industrial design focuses principally on aesthetic and user interface aspects. Again, I submit to you the iPod, the iPhone, you know, all of these consumer electronics in which the sleekness, the I've got to have this object kind of mentality is every bit as important as the functionality per se. So that's about goods and products. Let's turn now to behaviors or actions. And again, I found somewhat late in my career, but this idea of the duality is rampant in both the psychology literature and the philosophy literature, as a matter of fact. So even in 1985, Jesse and Ryan were talking about the theory of self-determination in which they distinguish between intrinsic motivations and extrinsic motivations for behavior. Extrinsic motivations, as the name suggests, refers to actions that are driven by factors external to the activity. So the activity is the means to some other end. Sounds a lot like derived from the demand for the true end, much as we say about travel being derived from the need to engage in spatially separated activities. So that's an extrinsic motivation to travel. And it's not always self-determined. It might be coerced in some cases, as in, if you don't eat your vegetables, you won't get dessert. That's an extrinsic motivation to eat my vegetables. But again, it's very much from outside and the means to the end, getting dessert. But there's also then intrinsic motivation, and again, as the name suggests, it's inspired by the intrinsic interest in or enjoyment of the activity itself. So that means that the activity is not a means to another end, but in fact the end in itself. And I came across this word, autotelic, and fell in love with it. Psychologists use it all the time. And it's clearly, as the name, you know, the prefix auto referring to self, and telic referring to goals. My mother was a marriage and family therapist, and she taught me about teleoanalytic psychology, which was the analysis of the person's goals. So if you understand the goals, then you can help influence their behavior, as in the case of raising children. So this auto-telic resonated with me immediately as, yeah, that's the phrase, the word I'm looking for when it comes to travel for its own sake, or the idea that the travel is the end in itself, not just the means to get it somewhere else. The literature, incidentally, also subdivides intrinsic motivations into hedonic versus eudaimonic, and we're not really going to dwell on that distinction, which in fact they say is pretty blurry anyway, so I'm mostly going to be referring to hedonic, but kind of collectively with respect to these intrinsic motivations. So what are some applications of these concepts, in particular looking at behaviors, if you will, again in the marketing research literature, dating back to 1982, we've divided shoppers into problem solvers, i.e. those who are obviously just shopping because they need something, and they may not like shopping, but that's what you got to do to get it, versus those who actually enjoy shopping and are considered fun seekers when it comes to shopping. Or again, the very words utilitarian and hedonic have also been applied to shoppers. The purchase decision process, other scholars are referring to this and talking about instrumental types of processes versus experiential, the latter being a situation in which the process itself is part of the fun, if you will. It allows me to express my personality or my status or my values in some way. So the act of choosing is itself the goal as opposed to what is being chosen. So you might be scratching your head saying, well, that sounds interesting. How does it apply to travel? Well, again, we've already seen that travel-related goods can have hedonic as well as functional aspects. With respect to behavior, I don't see any reason why travel should be exempt from the set of behaviors that can have both intrinsic as well as extrinsic motivations. And so, yes, the extrinsic motivations are the ones that we're always talking about when we say that travel is a derived demand, but I suspect and would like to convince you that there are also intrinsic motivations for travel, whether you call them autotelic, hedonic, eudaimonic, those are all potential reasons to travel for its own sake. So let me give you some examples of the difference between instrumental versus experiential when it comes to various travel-related processes or actions, if you will. If you think about purchasing, somebody who's instrumentally oriented is going to want to buy a car as quickly and painlessly as possible. I'm sure we all know people like that. Probably many of us are people like that. But on the other hand, there's these mysterious people who relish the bargaining, you know, allows me to display my status and my command of the situation and the other social aspects of the bargaining process. So I was married to one. I understand that some people are like that. I don't understand it myself, but you know, they relish the experience. And if you think about long distance travel, there are the people who just, well, let me get the ticket. I like it to be the cheapest, but you know, let me just get it over with, versus the people who love to check out all the options and research and make sure they're getting the best bargain and so on. So part of the experience is what they're going for. Means of travel purchased. I was giving a seminar related to this at that other school we don't mention, and a few years ago, and was talking to Peter Gordon, an economist, who reminded me that yeah, if you know the demand for cars were purely derived from the need to get around, there'd be no market for luxury cars, and there'd be a lot fewer SUVs than we see on the roads today. So for many people, it's just a way of getting around, but for a lot of people, it's a symbol of identity or a status, and lots of people buy more car than necessary, I think you would agree. At the extreme, you know, some people buy cars not even to drive them, but to display them or to, again, show a status symbol. In terms of use of means of travel, there's the kind of person who drives from A to B in the quickest possible way, for sure. Don't particularly relish the experience, but again, there are people who might deliberately choose a longer but more interesting route or a more distant destination, in part because they want to prolong the experience of that mode. Maybe it's bicycling or walking, maybe it's, you know, a train, but maybe it's even driving, and maybe they just relish driving even regardless of where they're going. And I know some people like that. In terms of long distance, again, there's the people who want to fly from A to B as quickly and painlessly as possible. But there are clearly, apparently, people who get a recreational vehicle and take weeks to go across the country when they could have done it in hours. And they're still, in essence, you know, their goal was to get to B, but they certainly take a long way around to do it. And finally, this is maybe more of the derived demand aspect, but when you get to the destination, we still have these instrumental versus experiential categories, if you will, where instrumental, gotta visit the in-laws, don't really want to, but keep the spouse happy or keep the kids in touch with their grandparents, whatever, as opposed to, you know, where the experience is a great deal of the enjoyment of the activity, namely, again, vacations in trendy spots. And so on. So hopefully you can start to see this duality even in transportation. But you know, just to give a more complete list, if you will, of some of these auto-telic motivations to travel, just going to put them all up at once because I have no intention of going through them one by one. Again, these lists have been around for a few years now, so I think you can read it more quickly than I can discuss it and hopefully again get the idea that, yeah, I can see that. What's interesting is when we started talking about this, people could readily see the application of these motivations to leisure travel. Vacations, yeah. One of the things that struck me when I was thinking about this at the beginning was how much of our leisure time activities are in fact travel. If you want to classify it, you know, hang gliding, spelunking, scuba diving, skiing, jogging, bicycling for recreation. All of these things that people do for hobbies, spend lots of money and lots of time on it, are in fact travel. And you say, well, that's recreation, that's not the same thing. Well, okay, so think about these motivations and then ask yourself, are they exclusive to recreational activities, or might they not also apply to everyday travel? And that's what we're trying to get across, is that, yeah, to some extent, they can apply to my commute trip, to my grocery shopping travel, and so on. And I'll provide more information on that score as we go along. So you might say, okay, Professor Mokhtarian, very interesting theory. Where's the evidence? And we were talking earlier about how easy it is to say, yeah, it's got to be this way, but let's not close our eyes to what the evidence says. And it turns out, I think, that there's quite a bit, and we're accumulating more as time goes on. So I'll spend the next few minutes going over some of that evidence. We will talk about direct questions about whether you like travel or not, or whether it's pleasant or not. We'll talk about your satisfaction, in particular with your commute. If there's ever a travel that ought to be disliked, it would be that one. We'll talk about the teleportation test and see what that is. I'll mention one study in which we modeled trip generation and included variables related to the positive utility of travel to see whether that had an impact on how much people actually traveled. There are a number of studies looking at the value of travel time or travel time savings that also suggest at least a positive utility of travel. And then there'll be a whole page of other types of evidence that I won't have time to get to. So I'd like to summon my first witness to this evidentiary hearing as the Nobel economist Dan McFadden, who said in 1999 something along the lines of, yeah, we've got our standard economic theories, but when you start approaching the consumer asking direct and unusual questions about beliefs and values, there are alarming variations from the standard economist story, which I might elaborate on, the standard economist story being, you know, that we're travel minimizers, disutility, et cetera, et cetera. So what are some of those alarming variations? Well, in one of our early studies, we asked, it turned out, commuters only totaled 1,358, and we just asked them point blank, you know, how do you like travel in each of these categories, 5-point scale from strongly disliked to strongly like, and separated them. These are short distance only. We also asked about long distance travel, but again, that's not as hard to convince people on. So focusing on short distance travel, here are the proportions of people who said they strongly liked or liked each of these kinds of travel. We put overall first precisely to avoid as much as possible the bias that people were influenced by the activity at the destination. we even wrote it into the instructions, you know, we're not asking about the activity at the destination, but at the travel required to get there. Still, having warned them of that, we know that not everybody reads instructions, and even if they read the instructions and tried to follow them, they would still be hard to kind of separate. And so sure enough, when we see that entertainment travel is liked by way more people than work school travel, it may not be just the trip itself that they're thinking about, but rather the activity at the destination. But when we started with overall short distance travel, in principle, they weren't thinking about entertainment travel in particular, but rather travel sort of generically or in the abstract, if you will. And so a third of the people almost said, yeah, we like or strongly like short distance travel generically. And when it comes to mode specific answers, that's really something about the trip itself, you might argue, that they're responding to. So again, no big surprise that people like walking, biking, jogging. But, you know, personal vehicle not far behind, right? And so high degree of liking for traveling in a car, let's face it. So again, entertainment, as I mentioned, high, but look even at the commute trip, which is stereotypically awful, right? It must be, I'm the exception because my commute's not that bad, but surely everyone else's is. When in fact a fifth of the sample strongly liked or liked even their commute trip. Even sizable number were neutral, so at least they weren't strongly disliking it. So, you know, a point-blank question achieved some pretty interesting answers. In the same data set, we had now dealing with 1904 people, because we included non-commuters as well as commuters, we had this list of 13 items that we later referred to as indicators of excess travel, meaning things that, you know, were definitely not necessary. And so we asked people, again, kind of in a very impressionistic sort of way, with just three categories of never, sometimes, and often, you know, how often do you do each of these indicators of excess travel? And, you know, a lot of these could be considered kind of destination-oriented, especially the top two, you know, to see beautiful scenery or to explore new places. Maybe that's derived from the demand to do those sort of things. But, you know, at least seven of these 13 are pretty much travel for its own sake, things like with no destination in mind and just for the fun of it and so forth. And what we found was that, you know, among those seven, half the sample did four or more of them, sometimes or often, and only 6% of the sample never did any of those seven. And even just focusing on a single one, you know, the just for the fun of it, something like 75% of the sample said they sometimes or often travel just for the fun of it. Again, that's not a numerical how many times a week do you do it and how many miles do you travel when you do it. But again, as an impressionistic answer, it's pretty interesting that people say, yeah, you know, it's important to me, I do it. Here's another study. So maybe you didn't like that, the first one, because it's a relatively small sample and it's Bay Area, those, you know, Northern California kooks, what do they know? But here's a very interesting study, more recent, and a reasonably representative sample of France. So basically nationally representative sample, weighted to be so. And of the sample completing a one-day travel diary, they asked people to, the computer randomly selected a trip on that travel diary about which they asked a number of additional questions, one of which was how pleasant, or basically how would you evaluate this trip, either pleasant, unpleasant, or neither pleasant nor unpleasant. So here are the percents of people rating their randomly chosen trip as pleasant as a function of what the trip purpose was. The overall in this case is just the average of all these categories here. So people weren't asked overall, that's just our computation. But, you know, for people making a work trip, something like 28% rated it as pleasant, et cetera, et cetera. So again, not surprising that people making a sport-related trip, you know, high fraction of them rating it as pleasant. But again, what might be surprising is that the work trip itself, and even school trips, and even shopping trips, which are supposed to be chores, right, were rated as pleasant by high fractions of the sample. Now, I grant you, and so the devil's advocate out there is thinking, yeah, but that's not the same as traveling for its own sake, and I agree. Just because the trip is pleasant doesn't mean I wouldn't not do it if I had the chance, right? But it tells me that there's not tons of people that are dying to minimize their travel. If it's, you know, if it were really that horrible, they wouldn't be saying it's pleasant, right? So it's not entirely a disutility, I think, is the message here. So maybe you're thinking, all right, well, how many trips are purely autotelic, you know, just done only for its own sake? The answer is not many, okay? So I'm not here to say, yeah, this is really accounting for the bulk of our travel. In fact, this same French National Travel Survey, for the first, and as far as I know, the only time really in a survey of this magnitude, asked, you know, a trip purpose that, in the nice French phrasing, was a promenade without precise destination. And so, you know, that people were, for the first time ever, allowed to give that as a purpose for their travel. I hope to see that on more surveys. I'll come back to that later. Well, also disappointing that maybe fewer than 3% actually gave that as a trip purpose. And in fact, 85% said, yeah, the only important thing about this trip was to go from one place to another. The traditional, of course, derived demand explanation for travel. But I'm saying, oh, only 85%, 15%, that wasn't just the only thing. And what I'm suggesting is that, yes, I'm not at all surprised that a relatively small number of trips are purely undertaken for their own sake, but I suspect that many trips are simultaneously fulfilling both autotelic as well as instrumental functions, much as the same meal, right, can fulfill both hedonic and utilitarian functions. The same shoe, running shoe, can be both decorative and functional, etc., etc. So just because not many people are generating entirely new trips for its own sake doesn't necessarily mean that it's an unimportant topic. So let's review some other data on the subject. Satisfaction with commute time. Again, the commute would be a trip that you would think if anybody would hate, it would be that trip. But there's some older research we've already highlighted in previous work that found when asking people about hypothetical trips and how satisfied they would be with a commute of this distance or that distance, the reported satisfaction was highest for trips of 10 to 20 minutes. There's these characters, brilliant scholars named Wax and Taylor and Ong and Levine, who did a study 20 plus years ago of Southern Californians who said, you know, asking people how satisfied they were with their commute, and of those with commutes less than or equal to 32 minutes, 94% were either highly satisfied or satisfied, compared to only 47% if their commutes were longer than 32 minutes. So the point being that if my commute is even as high as 32 minutes, very likely that I'm satisfied with it or very satisfied with it. In later research, we started asking people, what's your ideal commute time? And in my case, the study here, we prepared them by first asking a series of questions that showed both good sides of travel and bad sides of travel, and introduced the question by saying, for some people, travel is, you know, a waste of time, for other people, it's good. You know, so we were trying to counteract the perception that travel is a bad thing, necessarily. And so people's kind of unaided answer to that question was 16 minutes for us, and in a couple of other independently conducted studies, different continents, all English-speaking countries it happens, I don't know if that's significant, but, you know, the answers were fairly well clustered around 10 to 30 minutes, probably centered around 15 to 20 minutes. So you might say, well, maybe they didn't think about zero being a legitimate answer. You know, again, if travel were purely a disutility, then your ideal commute time should be 0 minutes, right? But maybe they were thinking 0 minutes would mean I'm working at home and I don't want to work at home. So that's why we talked about the teleportation test. Now, I never actually have applied this empirically, but we came up with it conceptually in this foundation paper back in 2001 and suggested the idea of asking people, you know, if you could instantaneously teleport yourself to your destination. So we still have that need to get to B from A, but can I skip the travel? Can I just get there instantaneously? Would I do that, right? And if travel is purely a derived demand, it's only to get me there, then everybody should say, yes, of course, I would teleport instantaneously. And you also have to realize that there's a built-in bias because of the novelty of teleportation, right? So in focus groups, people were saying, ooh, what a fantastic, fun thing to do. Yeah, I want to teleport. So there's a bias toward the yes answer, right? So it made it to me even more striking that, again, in four different studies, again, all in English-speaking countries, but, you know, different sample sizes, et cetera, but we're seeing 25th to a third of the sample saying, no, I wouldn't teleport. And what's also interesting, the same question was applied in a focus group, though the previous studies were more surveys or interviews, but in six United Kingdom focus groups, here's the reaction that emerged as the authors wrote about it, you know, that initially, yes, everybody wanted to teleport, but as they thought about it more and discussed it more, they realized that there were some negative implications of losing their travel time that they actually didn't like very much, and that they came to a more nuanced view as they thought it through and talked about it, and ended up discussing, yeah, there are some types of journeys or parts of journeys that I'd just as soon do without, but wouldn't always want to do without the entire journey itself. Then there's only one study that I know of so far, and I did it with my students in 2001. I would love to see others do it, where we, same data that I referred to earlier, and we modeled distance traveled, and we included, had you know, socioeconomic indicators, but then also what was novel was attitudes related to travel and personality traits, etc. And just to kind of give kind of a highlight, there's a number of variables that were interesting, but what we found was that people who were more than average adventure seeking actually, you know, measurably traveled more, both for short distance and for long distance, than those who were just average adventure seeking. Now, to some extent, that's got to be just natural selection, right? So somebody who's adventure-seeking is going to be more likely to land in a job that involves travel, or to create a job for themselves that involves travel. Or as the example we gave in the paper said, you know, if somebody loves grocery shopping travel, then guess who in the household is going to be assigned to do the grocery shopping? It's still necessary travel, so it's not an invented trip, but there's a selection into doing that kind of trip. So some unknown proportion of this overage, if you will, is just that. It's a sorting mechanism that accounts for travel that would have been done anyway. It's just the one who loves travel being the one who's doing it. But I'm pretty sure that some of it's excess travel. Again, if you think about somebody who likes to travel to buy groceries, then they're going to occasionally travel across the Atlanta region to go to the DeKalb County Farmer's Market on a Saturday and spend a couple hours shopping in the farmer's market and bring it back home and do some fun cooking instead of just going to the neighborhood grocery store. So they're going to some extent, invent trips or generate new trips that might not have occurred otherwise. So I'd love to see this, you know, replicated or refuted by additional studies along these lines. But coming to other transportation models, in particular mode choice, so I have gotten the question in the past that, okay, Professor Mokhtarian, if travel has a positive utility, how come it is that in all the mode choice models we see, travel time has a negative coefficient, meaning that, you know, more the longer the trip, the greater the disutility of the trip to the person. And, well, I have a few answers to that. One is that any model that doesn't have a positive travel time coefficient is going to be laughed out of the room because everybody knows that travel is a disutility, so, you know, you can't publish a model like that. But I think it's also possible that, and in fact, I mean, you laugh, right? But I've had consultants and seen consultants discuss on listservs and blogs and stuff. Yeah, you know, about a third of our models that we estimate out of the box have positive travel time coefficients. And we know we can't sell that to the client, so we just, you know, judgmentally adjust the coefficient. And I'm like, judgmentally adjust the coefficient? How can you do that? And So I grant you there's a balance between, you know, what's practical and what, you know, comes out of the black box of a computer. So I understand the need to be practical, but I do think there's something behind these frequently recurring positive coefficients, right? And so one thing that might be happening is that it's positive for some portion of the population, but when you sort of lump everybody together, then you know you're getting a kind of overall mushy average. And so in general, it will be negative, even though for some people it might be positive. And even if the coefficient really is negative for everyone, it doesn't necessarily disprove this idea that there's a positive utility of travel, because you're really trying to capture it the wrong way if you're using travel time to capture it. It's not really time itself necessarily that people are valuing about the trip, but some other aspect for which time is only a proxy. And so you're really trying to measure it the wrong way. And I can, again, understand the need for making travel time reflect the negative disutility that it probably has. But there's really no other way, though, to capture these other benefits of the trip, at least not right now. So I think, again, we have some research to do in terms of how to capture that. And I'll mention that as I bring it to a close at some point. But there are a number of studies of value of travel time in which they have found at least a smoking gun, if not real live evidence, of a positive utility of travel. There's a very interesting study that was looking at recreational travel, if you will, travel to fishing sites, but was able to separate, you know, the utility of the travel itself from the utility of being at the destination, and kind of balancing that against the cost of both the travel and the activities at the destination, and found that, you know, 2/3 of the sample had at least some positive utility of travel. The trip itself was valuable to them, and in fact, for 1/3 of the sample, that positive utility of travel is what put the whole trip over into the positive utility side of the ledger. You know, were it not that the trip itself had some intrinsic interest or value to the person, then the cost of conducting the activity at the destination would have outweighed the positive utility of conducting the activity at the destination. So the trip itself was needed, if you will, in order to make the entire venture have a positive utility on net. There's now a growing literature on people's attentiveness to various variables in mode choice models. And so here's kind of a representative example of that literature in which they sort of ask people after the fact, well, which of the attributes that we were varying in the stated response experiment, which of these did you actually pay attention to when you were giving us your choices? And it's very common to find that, well, lots of people didn't really even pay attention to the travel time variable in the model. And in this particular study, you know, 22% of the sample did not consider travel time when they were making their choices. Now, these are hypothetical choices, so again, you got to wonder whether that's the case in real life. But here's another group of studies that allow the coefficient of travel time in mode choice models to be a random variable instead of a constant. So when you force it to be a constant, then again, you're getting some mushy average across the population, and probably that mushy average is often, at least usually, going to be negative. But if you let it be a random variable, then sometimes it might be negative. For some people it's negative, for others it's positive, and you can actually, you know, compute the fraction for which it's positive. And studies that did that come up with 10 to 15% of the sample having a positive value of travel time when they allow it to be positive. In some cases, they constrain the distribution to not take on any positive values because, again, everybody knows there's no such thing as a positive coefficient of travel time. But when they did that, they still found, you know, a high fraction of the sample having zero value of travel time, which again is totally counter to the derived demand idea. Again, I'm not totally convinced that the travel time coefficient should have a nice, tidy, normal distribution and such that, you know, this percent of the population will have a positive coefficient. What I do know is that the data are trying to tell us something, and that it's, to me, an open research question to figure out what should be the proper distribution of a random coefficient of travel time. And if you restrict it to not be positive, you're imposing some distortion of the data as much as if you, you know, say, well, let it be positive, but we don't really believe it. Which is better? I don't know. So I think, again, that's an open research question. As I said, there's a lot of other evidence that we don't have time to go over. There's a growing literature demonstrating now, especially that we have GPS and can compare, you know, what people actually due to what we think the shortest paths are, and we find that a high fraction of the people are not taking the shortest path to get to their destination. And again, there are lots of reasons for that besides positive utility of travel, but that's certainly one of the possibilities that should be taken into account. Whole literature on how important travel is to the well-being of the elderly. And again, that literature often talks about the instrumental benefits of travel in terms of getting to doctor's appointments and social activities and activities of daily living and so forth. But it inevitably also mentions the value of feeling independent and in control, and the symbolic value of just being able to travel almost regardless of where you do travel. And my question is, why should that be limited to the elderly, right? If it's important to them, isn't it important to us as well? Again, similarly, the literature on social exclusion, often relating to the practical or functional disadvantages of not having good transportation or accessibility, but there's also a symbolic or hedonic component, again, of feeling in control and freedom and so forth. Big literature, even dating back to the 1600s, I found a classic reference to called The Anatomy of Melancholy, and one of the prescriptions for curing melancholy was to go on long walks, right? So there's a long history of travel as therapy, if you will, both mental and physical. And even today, there are modern efforts relating to horseback riding as therapy, dance therapy, and so forth. So again, to me, it's speaking to something fundamental in us that movement and travel is a way of healing us. The slow travel movement, gaining speed, so to speak, that the fastest way is not always the best way, and maybe we should make an effort to slow down and smell the roses or whatever. There's a growing literature now on the role of travel in our subjective well-being, and again, I don't think it needs much defense there. And also literature on activities while traveling and how those are adding utility to the trip. It may, again, not be making the trip for its own sake, but certainly reducing the disutility of the trip. So stuff is piling up. Seems like there's something here. What does it mean? And one of the things that occurred to me was this idea, all right, if the same trip can fulfill multiple functions simultaneously, hedonic as well as functional or utilitarian, it may also have an active versus a passive manifestation, if you will. And so I want to kind of draw the contrast in three ways. One, if a positive utility of travel is present in an active sense, then the trip itself does do something beneficial for me. Just, the act of traveling is positive in its own right. But, that may not happen all that often, or maybe it does, I don't know, but I suspect what happens more often is that some motivation is diminishing the disutility of the trip. So maybe I'm doing something pleasant or productive on my trip, and so it may not be that the trip itself is positive for its own sake, but I'm able to make it less negative. So if even that's at work, then that's something that we need to take into account with our understanding of behavior. The idea that, yes, some trips I may actually have a positive liking for the trip itself, but again, in other cases, I'm simply ameliorating what is an unpleasant trip, but I'm just making it less unpleasant. Is this pair the same thing? Is that pair the same thing? If you're doing an additive utility function, in essence, you're making that utility function more positive, so does it really matter if you're starting from a positive point and making it more positive, or starting from a negative point and making it less negative? I'm not sure. It seems to me like these are two different things and that they do have different implications, but I'm still kind of thinking that through myself. And similarly, the last one I think is maybe the most important one, that if there is a positive utility of travel, how often does it really generate entirely new trips? I'm on the order of 3% is probably the right number, but I suspect far more often it's motivating us to not reduce our travel, if you see what I mean, and I'll give you some examples just in case. So I want to contrast the passive and active aspects, if you will, of motivation, and I'll actually start with the active column in each of these examples. So taking transportation-related actions, starting with residential job location, if I'm actively implementing a positive utility for travel, then I may deliberately choose not to live too close to work because I like commuting, it's my buffer zone, it's I like, you know, experiencing the environment, getting out, etc. So how many people actively choose to live farther than necessary from work because they love commuting? I'm not talking about because of the school systems or my spouse's job or anything like that, but because I need a longer commute, I'm going to live a little farther out than this other perfectly good house here. Maybe not so much, but how many people are not motivated to reduce their commute because, oh, it's actually a nice trip, right? I don't mind the trip. We saw a sizable fraction of people not really minding their commute. And so even if they weren't actively looking to live farther away to start with, neither are they actively looking to reduce their commute trip. And I think that, again, may happen far more often. Similarly, with respect to trip generation, you know, on the active side, yeah, okay, there's the joyriding phenomenon, going for a ride, going shopping just to get out of the house, let's go for ice cream just to get up and move. Handy and her student, and I tagged along as co-author on interviews of drivers in Texas, and, you know, interesting comments came out that, yeah, sometimes I just get in my car and go to finish hearing my audiobook or whatever. So yeah, these things doubtless happen, but how often? Maybe not so much. But, you know, people who commute, even though they could telecommute, some of my research suggests that happens a fair amount. So there's lots of people whose jobs are well suited, managers are willing, but, you know, one of the reasons they don't telecommute is, well, the commute's not that bad, I enjoy the social environment of the workplace, other interesting things to do in the workplace, so they're just not motivated to reduce their commute. Similarly, with respect to destination choice, on the active side, you know, some people sometimes may choose a more distant vacation spot, not purely because it's more attractive, because I want to stress that a more attractive but more distant destination is completely consistent with travel as a derived demand, right? All of our demand models, trade off the attractiveness of the destination against the cost of getting there. That's just a cost-benefit analysis that we all do. So if I'm willing to endure the disutility of travel in order to get to a more attractive destination, that's not news. But if I'm willing to go to a more distant destination because of the challenge of getting there, so biking across the country or whatever, I don't know, that's the positive utility of travel that we're talking about in the active sense. But again, that may not happen that often, but what probably does happen pretty often is, I like this restaurant over here, even though there's another one in the same chain that's now, you know, much closer to my house, but this one's a more appealing route, you know, it takes me through an interesting scenery. So that's a case of, again, declining to change my behavior in favor of a shorter trip because of the positive utility of travel. Continuing the destination choice examples, you know, in an active sense, maybe I'll deliberately choose to go to this Starbucks today and that one tomorrow just because I'm a variety seeker when it comes to otherwise equal cafes. But again, something about the route might be different or the surroundings of the destination. But, you know, again, on a passive sense, there is one interesting study that shows that people who are more variety-seeking will have a lower disutility in the choice of, you know, destinations, disutility with respect to the distance of that destination. So again, in a passive sense, it's reducing the disutility, whether or not it's increasing the utility. With respect to mode choice, again, in an active sense, I might choose to bicycle deliberately for the fresh air and the exercise, etc., or I might, in a passive sense, keep doing something, that is, keep driving even when, you know, it would be faster or cheaper to take transit, but because I'm wedded to my car, I will keep driving. Or I might, you know, in a more benign example, prefer transit even when it's slower than driving because it does allow me to decompress and, you know, maybe even do something enjoyable or productive on the way home. So, I guess this one last example in this category. In an active sense, I might, you know, again, occasionally try out a brand new route just out of curiosity or to gain information about my surroundings or variety. But again, perhaps more often, I just stick to a longer route instead of changing to a shorter one because of the scenery or companionship or the opportunity to display some kind of skill or status and so on. So again, I think there may be these two aspects, and that it's not always going to be an obvious, overt manifestation of a positive utility of travel, but that we should look for it in the passive sense as well. So I just want to turn now to the series of slides in which I hope to inspire the generation of younger scholars here to pursue this line of inquiry, because I really have more questions than I do answers at this point, and quite a few questions, starting with, do we even know how much travel is purely autotelic? We have the one data point from the French National Travel Survey, less than 3%. But again, let's replicate that. I would love to have, you know, a question or two on some national or regional travel surveys, travel diary type surveys, in which we, like the French cleverly did, take a random sample of trips, so you don't have to answer all these burdensome questions about every single trip that you make, but just take a random snapshot of travel and ask, you know, specific questions about that random set of trips. For example, could you have foregone this trip altogether? You know, did you absolutely have to make this trip? Could you have accomplished what you wanted to do at a closer destination to get at this sort of passive, you know, I could have done it, you know, with less travel, but I didn't. Could you have taken a shorter route for the same reason? So I have very specific ideas about how I would love to design the next travel diary survey. So if anybody wants to let me help, I would be delighted, and let's talk. And, you know, even asking the teleportation question again to get, so this has not been asked in a national representative sample. So, you know, the several studies I showed you earlier were only for small, you know, potentially biased samples. So let's, on a national travel survey, ask the teleportation question, some, you know, post-processing, if you will, analysis of those studies suggests that you want to be careful about how you ask it and lead up to it and explain, etc. But I think you could get some very interesting, meaningful results from that simple question. How about, you know, what is the distribution of these motivations to travel, which you saw earlier? What is their distribution in the population? You know, for how many people is curiosity a driving force, adventure seeking, variety seeking? I'm guessing there's a normal-like distribution of these characteristics, but what's the variance? You know, what's the mean? How many people are, you know, way up there on this kind of scale? And how do these motives differ in terms of other variables that we might be interested in, not just personality, but, you know, lifestyle, but also stage and life cycle? One can imagine that you're a lot more adventure-seeking when you're young and reckless than when you're older with children to depend on you and that sort of thing. I'm reminded of Fred Mannering, a colleague in civil engineering at Purdue University, who was a motorcycle punk rocker, you know, but once he had his first child on the way, you know, he sold the motorcycle and settled down and suddenly became a model citizen. So, you know, these things change as lifestyle and life cycle change, and they would certainly vary, I would think, by our built environment and trip purpose and mode. So all of these, you know, more stable as well as more ephemeral context issues are likely to affect the degree to which these motivations are in operation for any given trip. And we don't know that. And what about, you know, other countries? I've already commented on how a number of these studies are from English-speaking countries. I would guess that whatever distribution we have of these characteristics is going to be different perhaps in China or in Africa or whatever. So let's learn more about, well, how fundamentally human is it, at least in certain manifestations. I'm asserting that it's some fundamental need, but we don't yet have that evidence base, at least as strong as I would like. How strongly does this influence choices? And, you know, now I get to some, you know, where the rubber meets the road, if you will. Can we channel this? Because, I mean, at least you're probably thinking all the way through, okay, if there's a positive utility of travel, how does it relate to our need to reduce travel and be, you know, sustainable and, you know, reduce greenhouse gas emissions and so on. So I wonder, all right, if there's a need for speed, can we channel it to bicycling or jogging? Does it have to be in a high-speed car or plane? Maybe can we channel it to amusement park rides? I just spent an evening at Six Flags Over Georgia and rode some rides that I wish I hadn't. Apparently, you know, note to self, if there are no other 50-year-olds on this ride, there's probably a good reason for it. But, you know, my students seem to be very excited by this, and, you know, maybe that was fulfilling their need for speed, and they won't need to, I don't know how greenhouse gas efficient amusement park rides are either, but anyway, you know, adventure seeking, that's going to lead people to, you know, go conquer new worlds. Can we somehow satisfy that on a local scale rather than a global one? Can we ever make transit cool enough that, you know, status seekers will actually love to ride transit? Maybe that's happening with Gen Y and peak car, I'm not sure, but Brian can tell us with his next study. And maybe, you know, do we even need travel? I mean, all those motivations I put up there can presumably be satisfied through other means. So if we really want people to reduce travel, maybe we should try to be getting them to fulfill their curiosity some other way, online. You know, again, I don't have high hopes for that replacing travel, but that's another talk. So then I start to wonder then if this really is an innate human need, as I'm suggesting. If we curb travel or, you know, start pricing people away from being able to travel as much as they want, we're going to be paying a price of some kind, psychological, social. So really, how can we measure how much we need to travel for its own sake, you know, just as part of being human, as a way of kind of quantifying the damage that we're doing if we curtail, you know, people from traveling as much as they need to in some level? Well, some economists would say that's entirely the wrong question, and I can sort of understand that. They would suggest that, well, the need is always going to be governed by price, by how much you can afford. So, you know, maybe all we have to do is, quote, get the prices right and let the chips fall where they may as far as what people need to do. You can only do what you can afford to do. In doing so then, by making travel much more expensive than it is today, we'll be pricing even more low-income people out of the market. Again, some would say, yeah, but, you know, high-income people have always been able to travel more than low-income people, so how is that different? Yeah, but maybe there's a value in making travel more accessible to low-income people rather than less. So again, I'm back to this schizophrenia. I feel like we're really kind of, on the one hand, understanding that travel is valuable. So, you know, here I was reading in Time magazine just a week or two ago about, you know, even though we're now talking the talk and really, you know, bringing sustainability into all kinds of corporate boardrooms and so forth, we're still, you know, increasing our carbon dioxide faster than ever before, and we're losing the battle badly because, guess what, economic growth means carbon emission growth, and as long as we grow, which, by the way, is the objective of every government and corporation, we're increasing greenhouse gas emissions. So it seems to me that this irony is everywhere. I think about a program in Europe called the Erasmus program. If anybody's from Europe, I'm sure you know of it, and it's decades old now, and the whole purpose of the program is to fund students to study and work in other countries, usually in Europe. So a student in the Netherlands may go to Italy for school. And I'm, you know, multiplying that by the hundreds of thousands, now millions of students who've done that, and going from their home country to a new country, they make friends from all over Europe and go see those friends and go see those places that those friends tell them about, and they meet a spouse from another country and they go see that spouse's country, and they get jobs in the multinational corporation and they travel all over the place. And that's exactly what the program was intended to do, right? It's intended to foster community and you know, a united Europe and expand people's horizons and culture. And I'm saying this, am I the only one who sees the, you know, conflict here with reducing greenhouse gas emissions? Because it's sure generating lots of travel. Even last night I was channel surfing in the hotel room and, you know, I'm on PBS, a bastion of liberal thinking, environmental, etc. And here's Rick Steves telling me how great it is on the Amalfi Coast of Italy. well, I want to go there, right? You know, does anybody realize that, yeah, the more you talk up how great these places are, and again, it's wonderful, we should be expanding our horizons, etc. So I'm now reading several articles in the academic literature in which, you know, these pro-environmental authors are wringing their hands over, you know, the greenhouse gas emissions, and they're doing studies in which they're interviewing people who are also often pro-environmental and confronting these people with the carbon footprint of their profligate lifestyle in which they're flying hither and yon to take vacations. And when confronted, these people say, in effect, yeah, I know it's a bad thing, but I'm not going to give it up. I mean, it's, of course, something I want to do. And again, I'm not giving mine up either. You can make it way more expensive, and I'll probably afford it. The one scholar I know who pretty much practices what she preaches in this regard is Kara Cockleman, who, you know, won't go to conferences because it's, you have to fly to get there, and she'll do a lot of video conferencing and so on. But most of us in academia spend lots of time flying all over the world. Elon Solomon and I used to laugh at how much travel we did talking about the, you know, potential of ICT to substitute for travel. And of course, before too long, we had changed our tune, or he always knew the answer. I was slower to come around saying, it's going to generate more travel, and I'm firmly convinced of that now. So here we are again, you know, with all the internet at our disposal, inspiring people to make more trips, and yet, on the other side of our mouths, we're talking about greenhouse gas emissions and curbing it. Also a good goal, so I just don't know how to reconcile that dissonance. Maybe you guys can help with that, but it seems to me that both of those are important, valuable, good things that we want to support, but it also seems like our policies are sometimes at cross purposes with each other. So, all right, I'm almost done with my questions. Can we incorporate, so this is now a more technical side, and I'm a discrete choice modeler, and so I'm curious, can we actually build in this kind of stuff into our conventional workhorse, used in practice, regional travel demand forecasting models? And in particular, you know, so far, this positive utility of travel idea and attitudes in general are in the epsilon, that's the unobserved portion of utility. And I'm toying with some ideas, haven't yet been able to put them into practice, but I'm thinking about ways in which we can take what we learned from these smaller scale attitudinal studies that I've specialized in, measuring attitudes, learning from those studies what the implications are for things like travel time coefficients, and transfer that knowledge to the regional travel demand forecasting models. I have hopes in that regard, but again, very open research question if you ask me. And I'm not even sure if we allow the travel time coefficient to be randomly distributed, whether that's really going to be the answer. Certainly it'll only give us limited information about the impact of positive utility of travel in particular, because there are all kinds of other reasons why the coefficient for travel time might change. It's already a huge literature that it changes with respect to socioeconomic characteristics and purpose and mode and so forth. So, you know, we're confounding a whole bunch of factors when we just look at a travel time coefficient. Might be expecting a lot for it to you know, account for everything. What should the distribution be? Should we exclude positive coefficients? Should we allow them? What damage are we doing when we do one or the other? And really, if you get a positive coefficient of travel time, is it really telling us that more travel time is always better, or is it a proxy for the amenities of the vehicle or the route or the trip, the activities I'm doing on the trip? Maybe it's an approximation to a nonlinear relationship. So we only model linear relationships of travel time to utility, but maybe I have an optimum amount of travel time that a trip you know, maximizes my utility. If it's this amount, then my utility is lower if it's either longer or shorter. And there's a little bit of evidence to that effect that I think we could explore further. So last slide on questions. Maybe the positive utility of travel is changing over time. A lot of people are talking about peak car. I'm kind of bringing Coles to Newcastle here because I know Brian and others here have studied this question. But, you know, if you look at the stats, travel apparently leveling off. Is everything I'm saying about positive utility of travel suddenly obsolete, or is there something else at work? And I don't think we know the complete answer to this issue yet, the peak car question. And now, of course, I have to bring in, you know, all the fancy technologies just over the horizon. What about autonomous vehicles? How will that relate to positive utility of travel? I could see it going either way, either of two ways. You know, maybe there's this huge latent demand for travel for its own sake that autonomous vehicles will liberate, because now I can, you know, spend the time enjoying the scenery instead of worrying about traffic, or, you know, save time in other ways that I can then spend on travel in a more pleasant context. On the other hand, you know, if my main joy of traveling was the thrill of driving, then of course I'm not going to be very happy with autonomous vehicles, and so maybe for some people it makes travel less exciting. And then I got really wild and said, okay, what about other disruptive technologies? Don't get me started on personal aircraft. People laugh when I say that maybe in my lifetime, but mark my words, in your lifetime, it will be technologically feasible, not very far away. I mean, they already exist, of course, but the technology requirement is to do the air traffic control and that sort of thing, and we're rapidly getting there. You know, if those are affordable and ultralight aircraft are already well within the reach of middle-class Americans and others, you know, that's a whole new frontier for travel for its own sake. Cheap renewable energy, so this is a rosy future, right, in which we solve the problem of greenhouse gas emissions because we figure out how to harness solar or electric or whatever. You know, I think we have room for way more travel than we're currently doing if technologies kind of line up in a favorable way. There are certainly alternative futures in which travel is way more expensive and constrained and regulated, and I think that may need to be a future that we have because of resource constraints. I think we'll be poorer for it, and that's really what has me a little bit sad. So finally, a couple of slides to conclude fairly rapidly. Just to remind us, it seems obvious, at least to me, that eating is not purely a derived demand. Sometimes it's actually the activity we are demanding. And therefore, I think, you know, given these other aspects as well, we create products with hedonic value as well as functionality, and we engage in activities for intrinsic as well as external reasons. Shouldn't these considerations also apply to travel? It seems to me, again, no reason why travel should be an exception. So what good is travel? I assert that it's a core human need and that it does have both types of motivations, sometimes at the same time. And so much of the travel we undertake for our daily activities is motivated through both internal and external reasons. But I think we have a lot still to learn about the intensity, nature, impacts of especially the intrinsic motivations and how to balance these costs and benefits. As I say, I really don't know the answer to what seems to me to be kind of tough questions. But I'm looking forward to some of you out here helping us to continue the discussion. So thank you very much. Marty has the first question.
I was told that the script provided for me to ask the first question. I can't do so without first saying thank you for brilliant and wonderful and stimulating talk. It was really great. And I've been worrying all along, how can I ask a good question? But one thing did occur to me. You spoke of the utility of travel, of the time spent in travel. You spoke of the utility of the destination, and you spoke briefly about the utility of the ancillary activities or additional activities that one can engage in when traveling. And earlier, we talked about, you know, grading papers on an airplane when you're not interrupted is much more fun than grading papers in your office. Why wouldn't the utility of a trip be sort of a non-linear and complex function of the interaction between all of those utilities? And I think the real, you know, the ultimate value of what, of the path you've started on is the exploration of those interactions. That, you know, they're not, the utility or disutility of your trip is not the linear sum of the three elements of utility, mm-hmm. but rather a dynamic function of the way they interact.
Yeah, I think it makes sense, and that's definitely a direction for research. You know, the 2001 paper that Elon and I wrote talked about the tripartite nature of the utility, and it was the utility of getting to the destination, which is the traditional derived demand, the utility of the activities conducted while traveling, and the utility of the trip or the travel per se. And so I think those still are the three elements, and I think we need to make improvements in measuring them, especially we made a first stab at it in the survey, some of whose results I shared, and what we found in that survey was that we didn't do a real good job of separating the utility of the activities while traveling from the utility of the trip itself. I think it's actually conceptually somewhat difficult to distinguish them. You know, if you talk about the looking out the window at the scenery, is that an activity while traveling, or is that inherent to the trip itself? So I had a little trouble even with the conceptual boundaries, and so asking people on a survey to make those distinctions is even trickier, especially since there's a lot of kinds of activities that you can do while traveling. So I think there's a lot to be done just in measuring the content, if you will, of that utilities, the different components of utility, even before you start to put them together into a total combined utility, and should it be interacted or additive, etc. So I agree. Yes.
This is sort of a follow-up to Marty's question, but it seems to be that the quality of a trip has a lot to do with the positive, you know, whether you like it or not. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering, like, if I'm a transatlantic flight in first class, would be quite pleasurable, but that same flight in, you know, coach with, you know, limited legroom could be very quite unpleasant. So, you know, same mode, same trip,
right?
Same travel time, but a very different travel experience. And even like bicycling, is like the same trip, the same mode, same bicycling mode, same travel time, but that's a safe bicycling trip versus a bicycling trip that's perceived to be dangerous, because, you know, so the quality seems to have a very strong determinant of whether you like it or not, it's not even so necessarily determined by travel time, it's what the quality of the trip is.
Absolutely, and even other things like mood. You know, did I have a fight with my spouse before I left on the trip? Might color the trip either negatively or positively. Maybe I need the trip to relax and unwind, or maybe it just spoils the whole thing and I'm on edge and more sensitive to other things that go wrong in the trip. We talked in one of the papers about the contrast between taking a trip for pleasure versus business. So again, two people even sitting in the same coach, you know, side by side in coach, but one is happily reading novels because they're on their way to their vacation and they're just enjoying the found time on the flight, and the other is stressing out over preparing the presentation at the destination that they're going to be giving. And, you know, exactly the same, you know, arrangement in every other way except for their personal context and what's going on inside, so to speak, which we would capture by looking at trip purpose. So I think there are all kinds of contextual aspects, both related to the vehicle, the, you know, what's going on outside the vehicle, the leading up to getting in, etc., you know, the anticipation of what's going to happen at the destination. So, yeah.
So earlier in your talk, you mentioned the distinction between hedonic and eudonic motivations, and it seemed to me that was really relevant to your last couple of questions, like looking at sort of where the positive utility of travel is going and what might be lost if people travel less. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that hedonic motivations are much more sort of like intrinsic to the actual travel itself, right? So the aesthetic pleasures like in travel are really about the travel, whereas some of the things like Stegg talks about in terms of like sort of like symbolic motivations or effective motivations. Like, so using travel, using my fancy car as a way of establishing my status, it seems like that's really sort of incidental to travel, right? Like if I were to travel less, I could just I could demonstrate my status through like a fancy watch or like shoes with like humps on them or something, right? And I was wondering if you had a feel for like the relative strength of those two different factors. Like it seems like there's probably more weight giving to hedonic motivations, but do you have a feel for the balance?
Well, I talked about hedonic more, but I would say that certainly a lot of travel might have this eudaimonic component in which self-realization, fulfillment is the motivation. So imagine, you know, climbing Mount Everest, it springs to mind, but, you know, so certain types of travel, it's, you know, the conquest aspect, and it's not necessarily conquering in an external sense, but rather conquering my fears or conquering my timidity or, you know, learning a skill and demonstrating mastery. So I think those can apply quite strongly to travel. So it's an open research question. I think hedonic might be more common, but we don't really know. And as I say, the boundaries blurry between them. So, you know, where does pleasure stop and self-realization start? I mean, most self-realization activities give us a lot of pleasure because we know that we're, you know, doing something fulfilling. So, yeah. Yes.
I've worked at a transportation agency for beyond 30 years, and when I came, the average vehicle occupancy in the peak hour, don't hold me to this exactly, but it was around 1.3. And it's gone down all the time I'm there. And the joke when I came is, hey, Steve, don't worry too much. It's not going to go below one because,
yeah,
you know, we need a driver.
Yeah.
But now you know that's not true.
Right.
We're going to automate, and it could well go down to a half or less.
Right.
We're on this route march to lesser efficiency in who's in there. And, of course, in 2010, where the United States was the number one consumer of gasoline in the world, anybody care to guess what political entity was number two? California alone, okay? Really bad. But contrasting that, one way is, of course, technologies or guilt tripping or getting people to travel less or whatever. But I note that 20 years ago and more, when I first went to Sweden to see their railroads, I was aware before I left that they were carrying people for a sixth as much a ton per person carried.
Mm-hmm.
I thought, I'm going to go see these Swedish trains that are so much more efficient than ours. They must be made out of fiberglass or something. Imagine my surprise when I got there and walked into the compartment in the train, and it was a compartment, but not smaller than the ones we have there. But there were six people in there and three folding bunks on each side. And when night came and we were all coming down from the steel mills in Narvik all the way to Stockholm overnight, everybody, and they're more egalitarian, half of the miners in the iron were women, but everybody just stripped down to their underwear, got in their pajamas, and went to sleep. It wasn't a sexy sort of situation, but it was that efficient use. It wasn't a new technology. They just, and they passed bottles of wine around. We were all happy. I would say we're happier than I would be being transported by a drone.
Yeah.
You know?
Uh-huh.
So, is there some hope that we can, just through a combination of culture and enjoying, those Swedes weren't sorrowful that they couldn't have a car all to themselves. I think they were happy with their wine and,
right,
and their companionship. Is there some future like that where we don't have to tell the poor you can't travel, and we don't have to say it to ourselves, that maybe just in the culture?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of this is culturally determined or at least influenced, and so it may well be that we're moving that direction. It reminds me, Alex, are you listening? My student said he would be watching this, and he is interested in autonomous vehicles and was doing a content analysis, really just starting it, so I hope I'm not giving away your research project, but you know, he was showing me these cartoons or, you know, depictions, I guess you could say, of, you know, flying cars and self-driven cars, which date back to the 50s and beyond. So, of course, we've been dreaming about self-driven cars for a long time. And, you know, interestingly, the images that were being shown in that era, say in a Popular Mechanics magazine or whatever, showing people sitting around playing cards while the car was driving itself. And what we're seeing in this era is people sitting on their laptops or talking on their smartphones while, by themselves while the car is driving itself. So maybe as a society we have gotten away from a social aspect to travel and more into an atomized, customized, personalized carcoon, so to speak. Whether we can get back to the other, whether we want to, I don't know. I think autonomous vehicles can certainly provide an opportunity for socializing in a way that we haven't had, but thinking about lifestyles today, they'd still have to change pretty dramatically because we're all still are going lots of different places. maybe it allows parents to actually pay attention to their children instead of, you know, having to concentrate on driving if they're accompanying them to the games or to school or whatever. But I don't know. You raise a lot of good questions that I don't have the answer to.
Okay, I think that we're going to have to, we're nearing the end of our time, and I'd like to ask Professor Wax if he'd like to make a couple of closing remarks, and then we'll close the lecture for this evening.
Well, I'd like to start off by thanking everyone for coming and attending, and especially thanking the staff of the Lewis Center and the Institute of Transportation Studies, Todd and Brian and many others who made the lecture possible. Mostly I'd like to thank Patricia Mokhtarian, whose talk I thought was brilliant and whose work I've admired for decades and decades. As you might imagine, when you're an old professor, there's almost nothing, no honor, no event that can be more pleasurable than a lecture given in one's own name. And I deeply appreciate all those who made it possible. The phrase, you know, the leisure of the theory class, it characterizes this. I love to come to events at which people talk about ideas, and we heard some wonderful ideas today. So thank you for this wonderful opportunity, all of you. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Professor Mokhtarian. I'd like to close this evening's event, and thank you all for coming out on what has turned out to be, a rather challenging traffic evening. But what you can do is just take great positive utility what may prove to be a very long, eventful, and circuitous trip home.
Write me about it.
So thank you very much for coming, and we hope to see you at other lectures in the future.